Alright guys, so it's time to do the field test for my Spectrum Noir markers. And this 36 marker case came in from Amazon. And I wanted to show it to you guys. It's made by Spectrum Noir as well. It's meant to hold their markers. If you've seen my videos where I review the AliExpress markers, some of like the fine color markers come with a case very similar to this. There's no actual internal structure, but I think these cases are pretty cheap, like $3. So if you're looking for sort of like desktop organization maybe for your pencils and stuff, you could put maybe a weight in the bottom, like maybe quarters on all four ends so it'll stand up. And then you could use it to hold your pencils and stuff, or you could use it to hold your markers. Like, wow, I only have six of these. Yeah, I only have six of these, and I don't want to remove these from their cases yet. But as you can see, I have plenty of room for them, but it's not going to hold them in any particular order. And of course, you could put other markers in there if you wanted. You could put Prismacolors, you could put Copics, you could put, you know, whatever will fit into this case. And it's got, this is really like identical to the nylon cases that come with the fine color markers. From the handle to the quality. But I mean, it's like $4, I think, on Amazon, so you're not really losing a whole lot of money. So in prior videos, I showed you guys how the markers look when they're swatched. I showed you how the brush tips look when they're put in place, and I even showed you a quick little tip for marking your Spectrum Noir marker so you always know which ones have the brush replaced. So now it's time for me to render this piece using these markers. And since it's spring, I thought Kara with some tulips would be nice and festive. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to select the colors I want to use based on this chart and put them aside so I have them for quick and easy reference. And a lot of the skin tones, I went ahead and I converted to brush markers because I thought that would make my life just a little bit easier. Now the brush markers still have the bullet nib. That's not the replacement. I mean, you can replace it with a different bullet nib, but it is not the nib that's intended to be replaced with the brush. So I've got my skin tones picked out. I'm gonna try to make room on the desk because there's a lot going on. Originally, I had wanted yellow and red tulips, but I think the best I'm going to get is yellow and pink because I don't have any good reds in this set. So that's almost all my colors, at least for now. After I do the skin and hair, I'll probably select colors for the dress and shawl. And we're going to start right out from the bat with one of the replaced brushes. And so far, the color goes down really smooth and juicy. There's plenty of ink flow to the brush. It does smell a bit strong, so if that's an issue for you, if you have a sensitive nose, if you're prone to headaches, or if strong sort of chemical smells make you nauseous, these markers might not be a good pick for you. Yeah, ooh, I got some smearing already. This brush isn't quite as flexible as a Copic Super Brush or Prismacolor brush. It is still pretty flexible and easy to use. Her skin turned out a little bit darker than I really would have liked, so I went ahead and I grabbed a colorless blender so I can push some of this color to the back of the paper. And hopefully it won't be too mottled an effect. That is one of the problems with using the colorless blender to push color backwards is sometimes it doesn't do it very uniformly. In fact, it looks like it might not work so well in this instance. All right, so I'm going to do another layer with the same color I originally put down, which is FS1, and it's from the pastel set. And one of the reasons I picked the pastel set is it looked like it had a lot of good Caucasian skin tones, which is useful for my field test. And one of the reasons I picked up the brown 6-piece set from Joann's was it looked like it had a lot of good darker skin tones that might be useful for rendering other ethnicities or other just other skin tones, period. When I use alcohol markers, I usually stick almost exclusively to brush markers. I just find them easier to use. But I didn't want to purchase replacement brushes for all of the brushes in these sets, because that would have been, let's see, 48 plus 6, 54 brushes, and the brushes come in 3-piece sets. So that would have been a lot of replacement brushes. And the replacement brushes themselves aren't particularly cheap. They're not like break the bank expensive, but considering they're an aftermarket add-on you're purchasing to make these markers more usable instead of an option, like a lot of art markers have the bullet nib option, and then they also have a brush nib option, and they're just sold as different markers. Like Shinhan Twin Touch does that, Prismacolor does that, Copic does that, Mexby did that. So it's really not uncommon for a marker company to offer the already assembled brush tips. The bullet nib on these is also a little bit scratchy and dry. There's no flexibility to it. And the brush nib they do have, while it is flexible and soft and really carries the ink well and isn't scratchy, it is sort of blunted on the tip. Unlike, let me grab a Copic, or actually I'll grab the Prismacolor because that's what I got handy. So instead of being like coming to a point the way the Prismacolor does, it sort of comes to like a blunted round end. So it's not really a cone. And that makes it hard to do fine details because it's just not finesse. It doesn't have enough finesse. And everything ends up looking a little bit fuzzy. And I mentioned in a prior video that although I bought two large sets, two 24-piece sets and one 6-piece set, it didn't come with any sort of a colorless blender, so I'm having to use my Copic blender for these. And I haven't seen the colorless blender sold at Joann's in person on its own. Your Joann's might be different, though. You might have better results. I mean, look, this one is really malformed. Can you see that? I don't even know how that happened. Oh, you know what? So it looks like... Okay, so the website and the packaging, which I don't have anymore. So you'll have to check the blog because I'll include a link to that. The packaging shows that the interior of the cap has like a bubble around it meant to protect the nibs. And I think these brush nibs, which are the official brush nibs, I think they're butting up against the cap and getting pushed down. Basically, my brush nibs are getting ruined by the caps on the markers. So that is definitely something Spectrum Noir needs to look into and consider improving before G3. Because we're already on G2, and that seems like kind of a big deal problem to me. I don't know, is that the sort of thing you guys would let stand? Is that, like, fine with you? Do I have any browns that would work well for freckles? Let's see, maybe GB8. Which I guess I pulled out? Yeah, no. So even though it wasn't the color I wanted to use, I think EB3 will be fine to put in some freckles. And I have to use a really light hand because bullet nibs do not know subtlety. And HB1 should be okay for adding some shade to her skin if I use a light hand.
looks like it's gonna. It looks like there's a high amount of solvent in this, so it looks like what it's gonna do instead is push the color. Instead of layering on top, it's gonna just go ahead and push the color to the back. So that really often results in a sort of a muddy appearance. And let's see if I have the next HB1. HB1 seems kind of, HB2, sorry. Seems kind of intense. It's definitely darker, so I have to be really careful with it. I was already kind of in that position. Actually, I might use those on her dress later. So, on the original Spectrum Noir blog post, somebody had pointed out that I should consider retesting because they had launched a new generation of markers with a different tip. Of course, they didn't mention that the tip was an optional tip that you had to buy. And I started researching into it, and I figured I would give it a shot. But seeing how deformed the tips end up getting just from being capped, I'm just really not impressed with the changes they've made, because I mean, if you're purchasing an optional tip and it gets ruined by the cap that comes with the marker, that's not really much of an improvement. They basically just kind of wasted your money by not doing proper testing. So I'm trying to use the chisel nib on some of the pens that I didn't replace the nib on, and I'm using it to cover large areas, as you can see here with the leaves. And I find this chisel nib, it's hard to sort of work around tight corners. And I know I can switch to the bullet nib, but a good chisel nib, like the Prismacolor nib, for example, and I'll pull that out in a minute, a good chisel nib shouldn't just be sort of like a rough piece of fiber. It should have a variety of angles that you can use as you twist your marker around to sort of best suit the situation. Unfortunately, this chisel nib is really not very good. It also sort of gives gaps in coverage if you're trying to pull long lines with it. Okay, so this is a Prismacolor with the bullet nib and the chisel nib. And right now I have the chisel nib for both uncapped. And as you can see, this chisel nib has a variety of surfaces that you can use, and there's no super sharp angles, whereas the Spectrum Noir is very rough cut, kind of not well designed. It's just unimpressive all around. Another thing that the Prismacolor marker has over the Spectrum Noir is the cap will post to the back of the marker, whereas the Spectrum Noirs do not post. And these are the two bullet nibs, pretty unremarkable, both of them. But I don't know that anybody honestly buys markers for their bullet nibs. So that's a comparison with the Prismacolor original marker
Prismacolor now has a brush marker as well, which I just showed you. All right, so it's time to start coloring the flowers. And I'm doing yellow and pink tulips, and I'm starting with LY2. Now, something that doesn't really make sense with Spectrum Noir markers that I noticed when I was swatching is the color families don't necessarily progress in any sort of order I'm familiar with. LY1 is more saturated than LY2. It's also brighter. Now, there just isn't enough really on the pen for me to be able to make justifications. I mean, the Copic marker system uses two numbers to give sort of like a spatial coordinate as to where your color falls on the spectrum. But it doesn't seem like Spectrum Noir markers do that. And I will try to dig up and share a color chart on the blog post. And if I can figure out if there is a rhyme and reason to how their color families work, I will also share that as well. I usually don't start really digging into the topic until I'm writing the post. Usually with these videos, I'm just trying to get the art done, get the initial feel for the markers that any consumer who's going to a store and picking something up for the first time and doing minimal amount of research beforehand would have access to. Now I am using the chisel nib. This is another one of the markers that I didn't replace the nib on. And I'm finding it very difficult to use. I've also noticed, and I think you guys can see it, the color application is very patchy when you use the chisel nib. So since the saturation is sort of patchy, I'm going to go ahead and do another layer with the same color to sort of build up my tones. And this is why, this sort of thing is why, as a marker colorist, I like to have a lot of pastels, because I can eliminate white splotches, and it's easier to cover an area that's already been covered with a pastel with a darker color and get a better saturation than it is to cover untreated brand new paper that hasn't accepted any marker yet. And I did get some smearing over here, even though I was very careful about erasing. It could be that one of the solvents used in these markers is dissolving my Mitsuo Ida solvent. Oh, more smearing. Lots of smearing right there, actually. So that's a shame. All right, so that marker's had a chance to dry. I'm now switching to the more saturated, according to my swatches, LY1. And so tulips that have two colors, the yellow tends to be at the top. And this would be a little bit easier with a brush, but I'm going to make do with the chisel nib. And I'm just doing sort of rough strokes. Which is really all the chisel nib is capable of anyway, so. And I can put that away and begin investigating my pinks. Now I want to end up here, and that's DR6 from the darks. And to get there, it doesn't look like it's going to be easy, but it looks like FS8 might help me get there. And I can just maybe blend between the two. So I'm going to need to start with FS8. And I am looking at Google Images as I work. Oh, cat sneezes.
I am trying to make it darker towards the bottom of the tulip. That's how it is in real life. I should also remind those of you who are new to my channel, due to this video, that this is not an alcohol marker tutorial. I do have alcohol marker tutorials on this channel, and I recommend you check those out if you are interested in learning how to render with markers. And I find it strange that the dark set only has one red in it. Some really interesting color choices. All right, so that's the base layer on the tulips done. Now to go in with DR6, which is going to be really dark compared. It's not so bad. We can make this work. And I'm going to blend it out a little bit with FS8. Now, I could have, I do have a fairly extensive Copic collection, a fairly large Prismacolor collection. I could have pulled colors from either of those, but because I bit the bullet and bought a bunch of Spectrum Noir markers, I wanted to do as much as I possibly could, because I felt like with 54 markers, I should be able to do something, right? I should have enough colors to accomplish what I want to accomplish. So I'm a little bit disappointed with some of the picks they included in the sets. Now I know I could go to Joann's and buy even more colors, but doesn't that kind of defeat the point of buying 24-piece sets? Especially if you buy two 24-piece sets and then one 6-piece set, like I really feel like you should get some good reds in there at least. I don't know. I know I have some crafters in my audience. Do any of you guys use these markers as your primary marker? If so, why? Like, I'm genuinely interested in why. Is it the price? Because they are fairly inexpensive when it comes to alcohol markers. But I mean, if you want a brush tip, you got to buy that. And if you want more reds, then you have to buy like the red 6-pack, and they just seem, and they're not really sold open stock, so it just really seems like a frustrating way to build up a marker collection. Or is the rationale, well, I'll get a few Spectrum Noir markers and then I'll get a bunch of Copics and a bunch of Prismacolors, and I'll just sort of fill in with the Prismacolors and the Copics, which are sold open stock, what I couldn't do with, oh, see, we're getting some bleeding down here. I'll actually see that, some bleeding there, and I could cover that with opaque white, and I am kind of over working some of these areas. Let's see what a mess. Yeah, it's bleeding through, but I would be interested in hearing why you guys, those of you who do have these, why you use them. And I know there are videos of people using them, their Spectrum Noir markers on YouTube, but I am most interested in what people who watch my videos regularly, what you guys think, because I trust your opinions.
I feel like I know you better than some person who's been paid by a company or donated supplies from a company. I can trust you guys more so than them. And this also isn't intended to be an attack on this company. These are my genuine opinions. This is my actual experience with these markers. I have not been paid by Spectrum Noir. I purchased these markers out of pocket. My opinions are my own, and I don't owe them anything. And as a customer, I'm owed a quality product. So, especially in a market as saturated as alcohol markers. And I review alcohol markers, like that's the most common product I review. There's so many brands, so many companies want to get their foot in the market. So I can't understand. I can understand your first iteration not being that great because it's, you know, your first time doing this. But I can't understand touting like new and improved generation 2 and it still has a lot of problems. I'm going to clean up that little bit of bleed on the bottom of her dress with a colorless blender. Just sort of push it out a little bit. You don't want to do it too much because it's going to cause a bloom into the green. 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 Ooh, fumes are starting to get to me a little bit. And it gets me a little bit, and it gets me a little bit, and it gets me a little bit, and it gets.
That brush is pretty terrible. It's like getting all bent out of shape just as I'm applying a marker to the paper. I wonder what's actually going on with it, because it seems like it's not getting a very good access to, say, the ink reservoir. And these are new markers, so this really has no reason to be dry. But it still wants to act like it is. But when I touch the brush itself against my skin, it feels really wet and juicy, so not really sure what's going on. Now, to be fair, I am using the same paper I use for all of my marker tests, which is Strathmore 300 series mixed media paper. This is not designed to be a marker paper. It has a high capacity to absorb ink, but it does tend to drain markers. But I test all of my markers on this paper. If you'd like to see me revisit another paper with these markers, I can do so. Just let me know in the comments what paper you want to see me try. Yeah, this optional brush is pretty terrible.
It's already, I don't know if you can see, but it's already looking pretty run down. Like the marker itself is going dry.
I will say that the rubber grips on these, they do help with capping and uncapping. It gives you something kind of to provide friction when you're pulling the cap off. For those of you who saw the Prima review, the Prima marketing
marker review I did, that was one of my big complaints about those markers, is they were so hard to uncap. They would like just fly out of my hands. So that is something that the Spectrum Noir markers have going for them. The price is also another plus. And, I mean, I guess they are accessible. I mean, they're sold at Joann's, they're sold on Amazon, they're sold through Overstock. That's fairly accessible, especially if you don't really consider yourself to be an artist, so you don't really go to art supply stores. You may encounter the Spectrum Noir markers a little more often than you would encounter Copic markers or Prismacolors. So accessibility might also be another thing in their favor. They're also fairly cheap. I'm going to have to double check what I paid and see if I can't find a lower price, because I did get them through Overstock, and Overstock is not known for their cheap, their good prices on art and craft supplies. So I will have to double check what I paid. But I think I remember it being something like $2 per marker, which isn't bad. It's cheaper than Prismacolor, and these are refillable, especially if you can find the refills. I don't remember Overstock having the refills, but that also doesn't mean they don't have them. It just means I didn't see them, and I will definitely have that information for you guys when I write the blog post where you can get the ink refills for these. Now, I do remember, just looking at their website, that the ink refills are more expensive than the Copic Various ink refills. So I wouldn't just buy the refills for these if you're just looking to augment your, like, alcohol spritzer collection. If you're doing that, I suggest you look at the Ranger inks. Okay, so now all we have left is her outfit. And I was sort of leaning towards the HBs, which is what I had colored done the shading on her skin with, at least for the dress, because I want something light and airy and billowy, since there's a lot going on in the background. And I'm going to have to color this twice, I think, because of the whole streaking issue with the chisel nib. Chisel nib is really hard to control, in my opinion. Because there's like a lot of markers have kind of a sweet spot, especially for their chisel nib, especially the Prismacolor chisel nib. There has a lot of ways you can use it, a lot of ways that'll give you the result you're looking for. And these do not. There's not a lot of nuance with these. So if you're looking to cover an area quickly, you're going to be sacrificing your ability to also knock in fine detail, because this nib just does not have that ability. And I am moving kind of quick, but I'm moving quick because I want to, the quicker you move, the less smearing you're going to get. So I do want to prevent smearing, especially because it's such a fairly large expanse to cover. And you can break that down. You don't have to, like, for example, anywhere there's like a fold in the fabric like this, you can just focus in coloring in one area and then move on to the next segment. And it'll make any sort of differences in saturation a little less noticeable, especially if you're going to go over it again because it's in shadow. And I know I have a bullet nib, but that bullet nib takes forever to color with, so I'm saving it only for the tiny details. All right, time for that second layer. The color is nice though. It's like a light blue hydrangea color. I'm getting a little bit of smearing in certain areas of the with the ink that I used. And for those wondering, I used a Sailor Mitsuo Ida to ink this. It is a Copic and waterproof
Fude pen or inking pen. I like them because I really like inking with brush pens. I can get more variation on the line, and it's a lot quicker for me than technical pens. And I pretty much quit using technical pens, except when I want to do colored line art and there isn't a brush pen available in that color. And Prismacolor and Copic and Sakura of America all make brush pens that come in colors, so my use for technical pens is drying up. So I definitely have a lot of sort of bleed into the fringe on the shawl. Now I can make the shawl a dark color, and that would sort of help her pop, but it would also like remove a lot of the airiness that's going on in this picture. There's actually a fair amount of difference between HB1 and HB2. HB2 is not just darker than HB1, it's also warmer, it has more red in it, whereas HB2 is a very nice sort of hydrangea blue. And this means the two don't really work all that well together. Because if you're applying shadow, if you're using a darker color to apply a shadow, you want it to be cooler if you can help it instead of warmer. Because that makes it not read as a shadow. So since my selection is actually pretty limited because the dark set has a predominance of dark grays, and the light set has a predominance of like peaches and yellows or yellowish tones. My option is pretty much BGR2, which is probably like blue gray too. It's not a very exciting color, unfortunately. I kind of wanted to do something that would pop, but unless I wanted to repeat that red I have up there, and I really didn't. My options were pretty limited. It's going to be another situation where I have to be really delicate, and I will still end up going over the line. So I'll switch over to the bullet nib, and this is just going to be super streaky because
Did you guys see that? Look.
So the bullet nib is like significantly lighter and less blue than the chisel nib. I mean, that happens sometimes in water-based markers, and it's always really disappointing because, like, look,
there's like an actual difference in color. Like, that is a different color.
What is that? It's like it's not properly pulling from the ink's reserve. Right, so that chisel nib, that bullet nib, really bothers me that there's like a significant color difference. Because, like, that just doesn't make sense to me.
Because it doesn't, Copics are set up differently. Are there any other alcohol markers you guys have encountered where the bullet nib is significantly different than the chisel nib in terms of color?
I mean, with markers that use a pigment, it can be because the particles just get clogged up. And I've actually had the fine nibs stop working on me because they got clogged up. But I've never had this happen with an alcohol marker. And it's kind of frustrating. Now it seems to be a little bit better. Like, maybe there was, like, blender. Even though I've been storing these horizontally, maybe in transit or something, these were stored improperly. And so the bullet nib didn't have access to the ink. So that would explain it. Or maybe even, like, some separation of the alcohol solution from the dye, and the dye all settled to the bottom. Could see that as well. And that would also mean that wasn't, that isn't a flaw in the markers, and it's not Spectrum Noir's problem. It's just a storage problem or a transportation problem. Now you can layer these markers, which is nice, once they've dried, so you can build up tones. Okay, so that is the basic overview, the basic field test of Spectrum Noir's G2 alcohol-based markers. I replaced the chisel tip of many with a brush nib that was sold separately in packs of three. And I found myself sort of disappointed in the performance of the brush nib, especially because the cap seems to compress and deform the brush nib, making it not work as a brush nib. Can I recommend these markers? If you see these markers on sale, if you see them at Tuesday morning, if you see them, if you have like a 50% off coupon for Joann's, or if you see them at Michael's and you have a 50% off coupon, these markers are not bad. They're not the worst alcohol markers I've ever reviewed. I have a lot of problems with them, and I didn't enjoy using them. And I found the chisel nib to be really scratchy and unpleasant to use, but I use markers often, and something like that would go from being a, what might be a small problem to someone who uses alcohol markers very rarely, to a huge problem, and it might even be a deal breaker for you. For me, it was a deal breaker. I will probably keep these markers around because I bought two 24 packs and a 6-pack. But I may end up gifting them to somebody, giving them to someone else, either another reviewer or an aspiring artist who doesn't yet have alcohol markers, because I want them to be able to have access to the tools of the trade. I would not recommend these markers to somebody who is familiar with alcohol markers, regularly uses alcohol markers, has come to expect specific things from their markers, or somebody who intends to use them often. I would not recommend these markers to someone who does heavily rendered multi-layer alcohol marker pieces. If you have a more simple style, if you rely on the white of the paper to sort of carry your illustration, if you don't use alcohol markers often and you see these on sale, these aren't a bad option, especially if you can get the brush nibs. If you're at a garage sale, if you're if somebody gives them to you, you know, I mean, they're not bad markers. They're not terrible. And with the brush nib, they do perform a bit better than the markers I got from AliExpress. But the markers I got from AliExpress, I paid like less than $1 per marker. And I know that's kind of not a fair comparison, but if you're an artist and you have to make ends meet and you can't afford to just splurge on art supplies like a lot of my readers, a lot of my viewers, then you're going to use the opportunities you have. You're not going to be like, oh, but I can only support a small business because, hey, you just don't have the money for that. That kind of discretion is a luxury that a lot of people can't afford to have. And I'm not
even saying that Spectrum Noir is a small business, it looks like they've grown rapidly in the past few years. They are a UK business, so if you are in the United Kingdom and you'd like to support your own, then by all means, you should support Spectrum Noir. Their main focus seems to be crafters, not artists. So if maybe I'm just like the wrong audience, but I personally feel like alcohol markers are alcohol markers and they should be designed in such a way that a crafter can use them, an artist can use them. And I feel like Spectrum Noir should probably have done a little bit of more product testing regarding their caps and the optional nibs than they seem to have done, because maybe that could have prevented the nib from getting, the nib that I purchased extra from getting crushed in the cap. If you enjoy this sort of content, if you enjoy these reviews, if you find them useful, if you've benefited from a review like this, I highly recommend you consider subscribing to my channel, because I do this all the time. I do this on the regular. I review a lot of alcohol-based markers, but I review a lot of other art supplies as well. I also do a lot of tutorials, primarily focusing on comic craft, because I am a comic artist. That is what I do. Watercolor, which is like my mainstay. That's how I make my comic and alcohol-based markers. If you ever have any questions, if there's ever anything I can do to help you, please don't hesitate to leave a comment. I do get swamped sometimes with comments, so it may take me a really long time to answer it. I'm not ignoring you. It's not you. It's me. Yeah, like anybody ever likes hearing that. But seriously, it's me. I get very overwhelmed with this. So I'm Becca Hilburn. I hope you guys have a great day. I hope you found this demonstration useful. If you want to help support the creation of more content like this, please consider checking out my Patreon, www.patreon.com/natosoup, NATTOSOUP, for more information on that. And if you haven't read my blog yet, natosoup.blogspot.com, I really recommend you check it out, because there's 7 years worth of this kind of content on there. So that was my Spectrum Noir G2 review, including the optional brush nib, and this one looks like it's been through the chewer. I hope you guys have a great day. Goodbye.